We are live right now. You're watching Dardan. He's from Albania, but he's also from Belgium. Dardan Zanunai, working. You have Joe Goossen in the house. Did you watch the Lomachenko fight?
Oh, yeah.
What did you think? You've always been a big, not say fan, but a big supporter of his, someone who acknowledged his talent.
Yeah, it's a line in the deep to me. I don't think anybody's going to beat him. It's going to be very hard to beat Lomachenko. I thought that. How many fights did he have?
12.
12,
Three division champions.
He's just getting his feet wet in the pro ranks, and he's already a three-time champion. So he's obviously a phenom. And, he's in the league in his own right now.
How big of a pay-per-view fight would it be Mikey Garcia-Lomachenko? The judges at that point of stoppage had it as a draw.
Yeah, no.
That's.
I don't agree with that, but hey,
it's boxing.
My opinion. That being said, I thought Lomachenko was brilliant. Guys, incredible. And we set him up at the end. It was a great undercut for them. We got a great left hand.
Straight to the liver, huh?
Twelve fights.
Out of three?
Well, even if he had 30 fights, it'd still be incredible. He just managed.
I don't think anyone in boxing history has won three titles, three divisions, in just 12 fights.
I don't know. You'd be hard pressed to find somebody else that did. We've known guys that have had 10, 11, 12 fights and won world titles, but not three of them. What, in two different weight divisions? Three
126, 130, 135. This was a real fight. This wasn't a gimme. Sometimes people fight for titles, but I could tell you how they're going to win.
When ours has been on a win streak.
Yep.
And I know he trained very hard and diligently for the fight, so. And that proved out in the ring because he looked good, It's just that she's going to
You have Dardan over here. He fights at 130.
Yeah.
Who do you want to see him fight next, Joe? Is there anyone you guys want to call out?
Well, it's not about calling anybody out. I thought we were going to get the rematch with Morales. He got a break in that fight against him. I think they kind of owed it to us to get back in there with him. I don't know if that's going to happen. We lost with it. They said they were going to give it to us, but I don't think we heard anything.
I was watching Amir Khan fight against Phil Greco,
And
I saw you, but more than Amir Khan, I saw Jonathan all over the ring, all over after. Dardan, did you see him in the Amir Khan fight on TV?
Well, Jonathan, he just got his SAG card.
What does that mean?
Swain
Atkins.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so now he's eligible for a movie. He got so much screen time on that fight.
Did you guys have fun in England? Business? I spoke to Eddie Hearn this week.
Eddie Hearn?
Yeah, he was in New York. Yeah, he has a deal for $1 billion. $1 billion deal.
The
platform that he's going to be on.
What?
A new platform that he's going to bring 16 boxing shows a year to this platform.
Oh, okay.
Now, he told me Amir Khan Broner, he would like that fight. What do you think about that fight, Joe?
I love that fight.
Why?
Well, because, it's a high-profile fight. Number two, I think... That Amir Khan was just about anybody that's high profile right now in the love. I think Broner's a great fighter. I'll give
Four division champion.
Yeah.
And he's a great marketeer. He knows how to market.
And he's a good champion.
Yeah.
And, I mean, he's talking about it. He's a good guy. You know, he's had a few difficulties in the past year or two. But like, he got started really late in the fight. I don't know why. And, what was his last fight? It was with,
Jesse Vargas.
Huh?
Jesse Vargas. It would be an explosive fight. We are live right now, so we're getting live questions. So someone's asking Joe, and they, I don't know how they knew that you would know the answer. Where is the place to get the best tacos in LA?
Oh, well, I mean,
Joe Goossen.
My preference, because I'm in the valley, is Takoyama. Takoyama is really the best. They got the greatest salsa. They've got very good carne asada. And so their tacos are, they haven't changed in 30 something years. That's why I like it. You know, when you get it, high quality. So they've got about 5 or 6 of them in the valley, maybe a couple down there. But there's one place that I really want to go to. My son goes to. It's called Tacos Leo. Or Leo. Tacos Leo. They set up at a gas station like at 12 o'clock at night. And they do the trombos, you know, with like chili and what have you. And it's
hey, Joe knows his Mexican food. Joe, do you? Someone's asking. Let's use this. Do you remember Michael Carbajal?
Of course.
What can you tell us about him? How hard did he hit?
Well, Michael Carbajal was, you know, I want to say flyweight. Was he a flyweight? Yeah, he was a flyweight. I think he fought flyweights 112. So I think he was a junior by 1 weight. I announced one of his fights, a guy named Jose Luis Papri, in 1991. And he won that fight, of course, and then he had those great fights with Peter Gonzalez in the 90s. He was an incredible fighter. Look, he was the first guy at that weight under a certain weight to make $1 million in a fight. So he was a groundbreaking fighter. He was an Olympian.
A little guy.
Yeah, I think he was 108. Maybe 112 at a certain point where he went to flyweight. It may have been 112. But, you know, he was an incredible fighter. He fought like a pro early on. It wasn't like he had to make a big transformation from amateur to pro. He was a great fighter out of Arizona.
Let me ask Jonathan, Amir Khan, Adrian Broner, do you like to fight if it happens?
Sure.
Why? To go fight. Then
I think it would be a very entertaining fight. Maybe so. But they had really good deals in England on Levi. Well, they were Levi's actually cost you a lot of money in England. They're like 4 times the price. So,
yeah.
But they have their certain brands out there.
Uh-huh.
Like Top Man is a shop.
Top Man. That means like.
The next thing, or next is another one.
JD Sports.
Yeah, but they were really good. I got great deals on them. And then, of course, there's nothing like the Camarillo outlets. So a lot of Jing
Jack. Camarillo in the house.
I own a lot of them. But my closet is filled with them.
So, who's your number one fighter in the history of boxing? Who do you have as the best ever? If you had to pick one.
I'll exclude any of my fighters.
Okay.
Just because. I would say, without a doubt, Roberto Duran.
He's the best ever.
Well, I mean, he's my best ever.
Yeah, no, it's your opinion, of course.
Yeah, I liked him for a myriad of reasons. Just that great run he had when he was in his 30s, he should have been retired. Pino Cuevas said it was in January of '83. Then he went in
and knocked out Davey Moore in the 54-pound title, which was an incredible, I mean, it was an incredible fight.
He fought our friend, Carlos Palomino.
Yes, he did. And when he beat Davey Moore, it was a horrible dismantling of Davey Moore. It was just, I don't think anybody expected it. And then later on, November, that was in the summer of 83, and then November of 83, he fought for the middleweight title against Marvin Hagler in a 15-round fight. I happened to be there that night, and it was a war all the way through the last round. Hagler won the last round, and he got the loser. But he was an incredible guy. He beat Iran Barkley.
You know, Barkley's this big.
6'2". It's huge. I mean, he had Barkley down. He beat him at every, from pillar to post. He was an incredible man. And then he beat Sugar Ray Leonard in his prime when he was 31 years old. And I'm talking about Grant was 31. It was an incredible fight. And Leonard was really a vicious fighter. People don't realize that. He was an incredible body puncher, incredible combination puncher. He had a heart that big. And with the punches that he took in that fight against Grant, even the 13th, 14th, and 15th round, man, he was rallying hard. So Leonard was an incredible guy, but Durant beat him that night.
Your last fight with Amir Khan, you had 4 weeks to prepare. Amir looked explosive.
5 weeks.
5 weeks. But Amir looked incredible. If you have a full 10-week camp, what could we expect from you?
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to give credit where credit due. Amir is the athlete, you know. He's a silver medal winner at 17. Youngest in English history. World champion at 22. Three-time junior welterweight champion. He's an incredible specimen. And, you know, if I have a 10-week camp with Amir Khan, I'll feel confident going in against anybody at seven.
Hypothetical fight, someone's asking.
Yeah.
Mayweather versus Lomachenko. Let's say Mayweather 135, Lomachenko 135. Hard to answer?
Well, I'll tell you, it is a little hard to answer, except you have to keep in mind, Mayweather does not like fighting southpaw. That would have posed a little of a problem right there, because most of his, you know, tuck and roll and the little style he's got, which he has perfected, really works really well against right-handers. Really well.
A 50-0, including southpaws.
Yeah.
He's also beaten south. Yeah, Robert Guerrero was a southpaw. You trained Robert back in the day.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, Jab Judah gave him a tough go of it. And so, because Mayweather's counters weren't really working against Judah, and after about 5 rounds of kind of getting beat to the punch, he just put his hands up and just marched them down. So he kind of threw all the cute stuff out and just pressured Jab to stop him. But he's never been a favorite of southpaws. And if they were to have fought, I'd probably still go Mayweather, because Mayweather has proven himself. Lomachenko was at 12 fights. Now, he's done a lot in that 12 fights, but I think the competition factor for Mayweather at a certain point in his career was incredible to anybody and anybody. And so, you know, give it a few years and I could probably answer that one better, but at this point, I'd say Mayweather.
Did you happen to watch Jaime Munguia fight Saddam Ali this weekend?
I did not see that.
Did you see the highlight? The highlight, that knockout was vicious. When he hit him, it looked like the jaw disconnected and moved.
Yeah.
Kid from Mexico, 29-0, 23-9. Was supposed to fight Triple G's, a 154-pounder. The commission in Vegas did not approve him because they said he wasn't ready.
29-0?
Yeah.
Not ready?
That, well, they well, I never underestimated.
So what, did that last fight convince him now that he's ready?
Yes, because now he's a champion.
So in other words, everyone else knew but them.
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
But he did his thing.
What?
He looked very impressive.
29-0, 23 knockouts, I'm sure he is impressive.
Did you
see the fight, I heard of him.
Did you see it, Dardan?
Yeah, I saw
it. What did you think?
He's a warrior. He's
only 21.
No, but he's strong. I think him with Triple G would be a...
Who wins?
Triple G, but that's going to be a bloody war.
He said bloody war.
Yeah, it would be a bloody war.
Are you working with Dana White by any chance? Someone's asking.
No, I'm not.
But...
I have no reason to at this point. But, you know, he's pretty much the UFC, and I'm not, you know.
Well, he may get into boxing.
Yeah, and Dana White wants to get into the MMA, so, you know.
Joe, someone's asking, what do you think of Manny Pacquiao having his friend Boo Boy work his corner for his next fight?
Who's he fighting in his next fight?
Lucas Matisse. You and it's fight of the year.
That's right, I forgot his fight.
Yeah. You were with John Molina. I was just in New York at a Boxing Writers Association dinner, and they had a list of fighter of the year, yeah. fights of the year.
Yeah.
John Molina against Lucas Matisse with fight of the year.
Yeah.
And you were John's corner.
Yeah, I did.
So give us an assessment of Pacquiao Matisse.
Look, Matisse is he's a very capable fighter. I hear Manny's doing well. I think Manny should be able to box him, I'm going to tell you the truth. I mean, as long as Manny's taking the game seriously, even though he's older now, he's lost a little bit, I think if he treats real hard and wants to get back to the, you know, the limelight again, I think if he beats Matisse, that's saying something. And if he beats him definitively. But I like Pacquiao in that fight.
There was a broadcaster who covered the Lakers for many years named Chick Hearn.
Yeah.
And when he started to get a little older, he started to confuse names of players. He would call Eddie Jones, Kobe Bryant.
Right.
So they said he may have lost a step or two, but he was still 10 ahead of everyone else.
Exactly.
So even if Manny loses a step or two, he still, but it's a great fight. And Matisse does have power to end the fight. So it's an interesting fight. He has the power to end the fight if he lands clean.
I don't know if he's a one-punch knockout puncher. He's pretty much a guy that wears you out, puts a lot of shots together, you know, puts combinations together.
Joe, who is the best amateur you've ever seen? Not best pro, best amateur.
Oh, Mark Breland was one of the greatest amateurs ever.
He trains Deontay Wilder.
Yeah.
Very tall, yeah, what?
He was one of the best ever, you know, no doubt about it, to me. I mean, he had 100 or something fights, and he lost one. Now, yeah, that I saw, you know, I didn't see Lomachenko coming up. Cuban, what's his name, was a great fighter, the heavyweight out of Cuba.
Another Cuban was a great fighter, 92 Olympic gold medal, you trained him, Joel Casamayor.
Oh, yeah.
He had, 400 amateur fights? Something?
I don't know if it's 400, but you know, the Cubans fight a lot.
Another question.
But I would say, for the guys that I really saw and watched, Mark Breland is incredible.
Okay, if Lomachenko fights Mikey Garcia, what do you think of that fight? Interesting?
What were you talking about, 55?
Yeah.
I think that would be an incredible fight, you know. I think Lomachenko would have, it wouldn't be as, I mean, when you look at Lenores, Lenores looked like he had a lot of size on him, you know? Very tall. I think that posed a little bit of a problem for Lomachenko. The other guy has a little I think it would probably be a more exciting fight with Mikey Garcia, to tell you that. I think Mikey would be able to land a little bit more often than
Lenores. You coached, you trained Michael Nunn. You guys went on a great run. If he fought Charlo, how good of a fight would that be?
Nobody in today's market beats him.
Why?
Just take a look at his games. I'm not discounting anybody, but I mean, Mike Nunn beat guys like Barkley, Frank Tate, the gold medal winner, beat Juan Valdan, Burns now. Hacker wouldn't get down, Leonard wouldn't get down. He knocked out Callum Bay, beat Mike McCallum, beat Iran Park, but knocked him out in 88 seconds. Mike Nunn was a 6'2 left-hander, fleet of foot. He had, you know, he had surround vision. He could be in front of you, he couldn't get on.
Like Lomachenko.
He was, I think, even a little bit more spectacular than Lomachenko, whatever he said.
So the knockouts.
Not just the knockouts, I think he was just a lot more exciting in a way. But not to diminish anybody there, but to me, Mike Nunn was literally, like I say about Lomachenko, was unbeatable. He was unbeatable. He had the same qualities as Lomo, but he had blinding hand speed. He would turn on you magnificently. He had power. He beat all the top guys. I don't know what else I can say about him. People that look back at his highlights reels, they go, man, I didn't know. Who didn't know who Mike Brown, they look and they go, man, that guy may be one of the greatest fighters.
People forget, when you stop becoming an active athlete, you lose a lot of interest. It's just no. Yeah. A question here, Joe. I don't know. It's a weird question, but I'll ask you. What are the best vegetables that fighters need to eat?
The green, the dark green vegetables. Because they carry a lot of minerals, you know. So any of the dark green, those are the minerals that you need to replace when you sweat a lot. Yeah.
What is that?
I like spinach, broccoli, asparagus, any of those dark greens. Even when it comes to lettuce, I have to use the lettuce.
Green for the honey, something for the money. What's that old saying?
I don't know.
Something, there was a pimp, a very famous pimp that used to walk around Hollywood and used to say those sayings.
Yeah, missed that one.
Jonathan, hello. Iceberg Slim, what was his saying? Green for the honey? Okay,
Okay.
All right, so Joe, let's take the last question of the day. Let's see. Hold on. Hey, they said they're reporting this because you were abusing the heavy bag.
That was a half an hour straight on the heavy bag.
That's crazy. Dartan could crack.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Danny Garcia versus Sean Porter.
Well, that's a tough one. I tend to probably lean towards Danny Garcia because he's a little bit more technically sound. Than Sean, but Sean's a handful. He's all over the place. He's all over you. You know, he never stops punching, top to bottom, left to right. He's very awkward that way. And you know, so I you like that show, huh? So come here, you'll talk. Yeah. So I like. Our friend from Israel right now, we just
got here in
the United States, no problem. 122 pounder.
Israel just won the Eurovision.
Yeah.
You saw that?
Yeah,
she makes sounds like a chicken.
Yeah.
Here, the rappers make sounds like birds.
She makes sounds
like Yeah, she does. She makes sounds like a chicken.
Is this good marketing for Israel?
Yeah, good marketing. She's a very heavy set lady. She's a big lady. So good for her. Like,
yeah, sure.
She did her thing. Was the Medrick Taylor Chavez stoppage legit or not? A fan is asking, Joe.
That's a tough one. If I would have been in Taylor's corner, I would have been awful PO'd.
Why? Because you're winning the whole fight?
Well, yeah, there's 3 seconds left, you know, and you're winning the whole fight. Now, that being said, here's the problem, is that the referee is under no obligation to be concerned with what the official time clock says. You know, his whole thing is to make a split-second judgment based upon what's in front of me at the time. Now, I will tell you the big mistake, because I was there, it happened to me once. The big mistake was is that in the corner, let's say Lou Dubin was in this corner over here, and Meldrick Taylor was getting the count over here in this corner, Dubin got his attention. He probably wanted to do it, most trainers do, like, you know, hold on.
Yeah.
You know, so what happened was, Meldrick Taylor, if I'm Meldrick Taylor, you were...
Chavez.
No, the referee.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Was...
Where are you like?
I'll remember in a second.
YouTube, yeah.
Anyway, so what happened was Meldrick Taylor's attention got taken away over to the right, the corner, and so when Richard Steele was the referee, was giving him the count and talking to him and asking him to respond, Meldrick Taylor looked away, see, to his corner. This is corner. Was right going,
Yeah.
And it was one of those situations where he wasn't paying attention to the referee, and the referee's asking him to do something.
Come forward, shake your head.
He was forgetting it, you know?
Wow.
So it was kind of a bummer for Taylor because he really put out great in that fight, and he probably should have won it. But, you know, strange things happen in boxing, and that was definitely a strange one. You could argue it was very unfair. But, again, the corner distracted him. And then he took his attention away from the referee and Meldrick Taylor turned, and that was that. He wasn't giving the proper responses that Richard Steele was looking for.
And his whole stuff, a loss like that could ruin someone's life, someone's career, legacy, everything.
It would certainly, for the moment, put a real, bummer on the situation. I mean, it's not nothing you couldn't come back and they fought again. But, the next time they fought, it was clear cut. Child is destroyed.
So Joe, message to fans if they're watching. We have about 105 people with us right now.
Oh, okay. Well, listen, it's the fans out there that really make the wheels turn in this game. And they love the sport as much as I love the sport because originally I was a fan, But I was such a fan that I wanted to actually do it for a living. So I can relate to the fans out there watching this and how much time and effort and love they have for the sport. So just to say thank you very much for all your support for the whole game, not just me or anybody else. I appreciate it.
All right. Oh, last week I meant to come by, but I wasn't here. I was in New York. It was, how many years anniversary to Diego Corrales-Castillo fight?
Well, that was 2005.
13 years. Did you get a lot of phone calls? Because you worked Diego Corrales' corner that fight.
Whenever they show the Corrales-Castillo fight, whenever they show it, I get calls from people who have somehow never had seen it before, or ones that hadn't seen it in a long time. And they just all remark. A once in a lifetime type of fight.
Diego got dropped numerous times.
In that fight? Twice.
Yes, but they were hard ones. It wasn't easy ones. No, sometimes it's a flash knockdown where you just rub it off.
Right.
He came back to stop Castillo.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you did. Well, no, those two. The first knockdown was a plain left hook. I mean, Diego almost did what Lomachenko did. Was it the sixth round, maybe? Lomachenko was kind of having his way, and he walked out very casually in front of Linares. And threw a punch and got countered with a straight right hand. And then after that, you saw he kept his head moving when he got closer, which he had been doing earlier. He just had a momentary lapse of reasoning, as they say. And I think the same thing happened to Diego. He had a great ninth round, and he kind of walked out into the tenth round like, I don't have much to worry about here. And
he got caught.
Castillo put a feint downstairs, and then he dropped his hand to block it. He really didn't bite on that too often that night, but in the 10th round he bit on it, and he got a drop, and then got up and got dropped again. But the second time he got up stronger than the first time. The first time he looked like he was in real trouble.
Yeah.
He had such great conditioning for that fight, I have to tell you, that he was able to recoup very quickly. And I think the second time he got up, Castillo was probably like, what am I gonna do, And believe it or not, that can take a little heart out of you when you put a guy down twice and he keeps getting up. And then he comes back and starts firing on you. Sometimes that can just, flip the script real quick, and that's what happened.
Given that he was dropped twice, if they went to the scorecards in the end of the fight, who would have won? If Corrales didn't stop Castillo, would he still have won?
Well, I thought he was winning the fight. Tough one to overcome, having it dropped twice in the 10th round, so,
10-7 round.
Yeah, and so that would have set us back a little bit if it was close. To tell you the truth, I don't even know what the scorecards were. I think we may have been ahead. I thought we should have been when we swept the early rounds, for sure. The middle rounds were a little bit more of a tug of war. And then, we finished in the 10th, so it's a moot point. But, that was,
Would you have liked to see Diego Corrales Lomachenko, 135, 135? I mean, Corrales was what, 6'1", 6'2"?
No, Corrales was 5'0".
But he seemed taller.
Yeah, because everyone else was shorter.
Okay.
But, in the Corrales, here's the thing, is that, I think Corrales was an exceptional fighter, from a distance or in close. And for him to be able to dissect Castillo on the inside in the early rounds was a real accomplishment because nobody really ever challenged Castillo very often to a nose-to-nose game. And I think had, Lomachenko
He doesn't mind getting close to you because he'll get angles on you. So he doesn't mind getting close.
Very quick hands, too.
Yeah. But, again, if you got close to Diego, you were putting yourself in jeopardy. Now, again, Casamayor was a gold medal winner. Was an exceptional fighter. He got dropped by Diego, in the sixth round. And even though we had Diego down twice earlier in that fight, it's all speculation on my part.
Yeah.
I think Diego would have done better than Linares. Let's put it that way.
And then after you beat Casamayor, he came to train with you, right?
Pardon?
You guys beat Casamayor, and then he came to train with you, correct?
No. Casamayor was with me.
Yes.
He beat Corrales.
And then he came to train with you.
Yeah, we fought Corrales, me and Joel. Actually, Joel fought him, a trainer for the fight. On the undercard of the Holyfield James Toney fight.
And James won that one in the ninth round.
He looked great.
That's a 160 pounder. Joe, I don't see any 160 pounder today, and they're all great champions, moving up and fighting Wilder or Joshua.
James Toney is a Hall of Fame fighter, period.
Top five greatest fighters ever?
One of the greatest fighters I've ever seen. He was incredible. Now, that being said, I had Casamayor for a number of years, probably 6 years at that point. And we fought Corrales, Casamayor, stopped Corrales, I think, in eight. And then there was a little bit of a kerfuffle management-wise, and Diego had fired his trainer, and there was a little bit of a management thing going on here that didn't work out. It was a business thing. And I ended up switching. I got hired by Corrales to fight my former fighter of 6-7 years, Joel Casamayor, which did not sit with me very well at all. But business is business, and I had Corrales against my old fighter Casamayor in the immediate rematch. There was neither guy took a fight. It was Casamayor beat Corrales. Corrales fights Casamayor, but I was in one corner for the first fight.
Then you switched.
No.
How did the second fight turn out?
Well, I happened to be in the corner of both winning fights. So, fighters, I should say.
But I will say this. When I see Joel Casamayor now, and I mention your name, his face lights up. He loves you.
No, I love Joel Casamayor.
Even though you...
So I said it did my heart no good when Casamayor, because of the business, had to be pulled out of my gym. No, Casamayor had... We had a very, very tight relationship. He was very appreciative of what I did for him, and I was appreciative that he appreciated it. So it made our bond really strong. We both counted on each other, and he was an incredible fighter to begin with. I had a lot of good material to work with, but there was a transformative period that we needed to get, locked in with him that he didn't have. So. But no, Casamayor, if I see Casamayor, I'm just brushing everybody aside and I'm running up to him.
All right. Yeah. Let me ask Dardan one question. Dardan, how do you like working with Joe?
Man, he's a monster. He's a monster.
Who's a monster? You?
Yeah.
Why is he a monster?
He's in your back from the beginning to the end. For inside fight.
He doesn't, no breaks.
No, but he's the best. He sees things that I don't know where he sees it.
Yeah, I have a lot of people tell me that. Joe, you see things that other people don't see.
No, man, I think he's the smartest trainer.
Smart? In boxing. You look in shape right now. What are you, 131 today?
No, I'm like 138.
138, doesn't have a fight date, and he fights at one. That's very impressive. Most fighters between fights balloon up.
No, Darden is, he's waiting for a mission right now. We're going to get one. Yeah. So he's... He didn't come here from Belgium by way of Albania to sit around and get heavy. He came here he's on a mission right now,
All right, look out for Dardan Zanune. Stay tuned. Joe Goossen in the house. Hope you guys had a good time watching this live feed. We're going to get going. We'll be back.
Thanks, Al.